couple of slides, and then when you're back in the office, you can double check if you have those and if you understand those. So I have a couple of hints as well. Interaction between host and supervisor. Are they reliable partners? How do you define reliability in partners there? Let's not go there. Are they suitable for the purposes of my individual fellowship project? So do they have experience with what that is? Or do you need to explain to them what IF means? The first is better, of course. I think one of the testimonials before said it, that they wouldn't have done it without the professor helping them, because the professor knew about individual fellowships. That's a key element. You need people who are experienced. And if not the professors themselves, then definitely the support mechanisms. So research support offices in the particular university. Or better, the national contact points there, etc., etc. Is the organization able to provide the necessary resources? So you saw some of the testimonials before, they were talking about instrumentation that is there, and so on and so forth. But not only that. Resources is also the administrative support, the proposal writing offices, the connection to the national contact points, the administrative and logistics staff. You need to keep an eye on those. Working conditions. The charter and code, remember I mentioned this document before, the European Charter for Researchers and the Code of Conduct for the Recruitment of Researchers, mentions some standards about working conditions for researchers. Go find the document, check out what the standards are, and make sure you at least discuss with the host organization how they cover some of those. I have a question though. Sorry, I kept waiting. Yeah.
It may be for France in particular, but I was wondering, for France, there is a CNRS and the universities. And so, for example, in my case, I asked my supervisor, or my future supervisor, if I get a fellowship, who would be the best? And they told me that I should ask the CNRS to be the big organization, but I feel it a little bit strange because the CNRS is at the French level, not at the, like...
Who would be the best for what? To support you?
To be the beneficiary...
Oh, okay.
And I was wondering if it was a good idea.
All right. Now, the beneficiary is the university, to put it in simple terms. The beneficiary is the recipient of the grant. So it is the host institution where you will actually go.
But so, for example, the supervisor is not working for the university because he is a CNRS researcher.
So you should put CNRS then. But this is quite particular, right?
Yeah.
This is, the hint for everyone is the beneficiary is the host institution of your supervisor. Okay, so 99% of the time, the university that she or he is working at. Right? Do they, the supervisor and the host, do they bring added value to the career development of the fellow? You see some things I keep repeating, career development, etc., etc. You must show how the supervisor and the host are providing you with opportunities for diversifying your skills, to broaden your skill set, both scientifically and in terms of soft skills. I will come to that later. A good match, what does it mean? You have an experienced supervisor with track record. You have relevant expertise and skills. Infrastructure and resources is a must. The triple I dimension and the triple helix is a good thing to investigate if it is present or not. Multidisciplinarity, interdisciplinarity, complementarity and synergies. This is again Russell's English, but you can understand. Yes? One of the testimonials also mentioned it. I'm sorry, I forget who, but I saw complementary skills there. This is what you need. You need a two-way transfer of knowledge, both from the host and the supervisor to you, and from you to the host. This is why you need European added value. This is how things come together. Everything makes sense and everything is interconnected. It's not just bits and pieces glued together to make a proposal. Everything has to flow and to make sense. Commitment. Where should I look for a host and a supervisor? Or if you are a supervisor and a host, where should I look for a fellow? Well, these things are obvious, but I put them here anyway. Personal contacts with people in institutions you've worked before. Previous collaborations in EU projects. I think your national contact point also presented already some of the ways for that, particularly for Japan. But this is universal truth. contacts for participation in working groups and committees. Why are these here? Hint, hint, if you don't have them, go do them. Okay? But frequently you don't have time and you want to see how I can find a good host and a good supervisor, but not through the networking that I just presented now, where there are some tools, right? And there are some validated tools. This is the most important. So I'm not just looking up in LinkedIn and ResearchGate. Yes, this is an option. But it's down here, as you see. There are more validated offers. First of all, Net for Mobility Expression of Interest. Net for Mobility is the European project of national contact points. So you have all the national contact points of all the countries involved there. Right? So they have prepared a web page, netformobility.eu. By the way, visit it because it has a lot of assistance. /UE, expression of interest. So there, in that URL, you can find which organizations in Europe have already expressed an interest to host researchers for individual fellowships. So that's a good place to look for potential hosts. Same principle, different website, your access hosting offers. They are both European initiatives. So they are validated. It's not just anyone posting there, yeah, I want to host a researcher. Good sources. Another good way, through the COST actions. COST actions is another European program which funds scientific networking. Okay? Another good way to potentially find code. Yes, please.
No, just about the hosting offers. There are actually now already more than 1,000 hosting offers active. So you can check them.
Yeah. So it's not just validated things. There's a lot of them. Okay? And it's inter-scientific, so it's not only about the field, one field of science or not. Yes, please.
How a person, you know, or researcher or professor can become a host?
How?
Oh.
Okay, then the practice is you contact your research support office at the university.
Okay.
You tell them I am interested in expressing my interest in your access or network mobility to host a researcher from abroad in this particular field. Can you please send our expression of interest to the national contact point, if in this case, and the national contact point will forward it to Network Mobility. Can you please send my interest to the local national your access services office or your acquisition, and they will forward it. Okay, so it is, you express first to your entity, to your organization, and then they take it to the national contact point or the your access services center, respectively. It is very easy process and fast. So yes, that was a good question actually, because you might be interested in hosting researchers because maybe you are permanent staff or whatever. Now, for professors here in Japanese universities and researchers, it might be also very interesting to say that you are interested in hosting global fellowships. Okay? So to host the outgoing from Europe, the outgoing phase of global fellowships. That also might be very interesting, and I see Mathieu nodding his head, so talk to him. All right, let's move on. Key messages. Yeah, if you want to be engaged in Marie Curie individual fellowships as a supervisor, define your project and what you want, expertise, experience, etc. Ensure the eligibility of the fellow that you want to recruit. Evaluate each candidate. Inspire the career development of the fellow. Again, something that recurs. If you want to apply as a fellow, you must advertise your interest in Marie Curie individual fellowships. You must ensure that the host and the supervisor are a concrete advancement for your skills and your competency development. And you must attract the attention of coordinators because they usually have little time. So your profile and your expression of interest may be sometimes the only information they have for you. Now, eligibility rules. In Marie Curie individual fellowships. There are two basic eligibility criteria, the experience criterion and the mobility criterion. The experience criterion says, and this is just copy-paste from the guide for applicants, page 4, you see, the researchers that are eligible to apply for Marie Curie individual fellowships are experienced researchers. What does that mean in Brussels English? Experienced researcher is someone who at the date of the call deadline, so on September 14, 2017 this year, is in possession of a doctoral degree. So A, you are a PhD holder. B, if you are not a PhD holder, you must be able to prove at least 4 years of full-time research experience. Now, what does that mean, full-time research experience? There's a definition in the guide for applicants. I will not waste time explaining to you why, because rule of thumb, under my experience, don't try if you're not a PhD holder. This is not in the rules, and since it's being recorded, the rule says that you can apply even if you're not a PhD holder, but you must prove at least 4 years of full-time experience. Experience shows this is a postdoc fellowship. So it is, let's say, much easier if you are a PhD holder. Okay, you get the message? Mobility rule. Thank you for that. Mobility rule. Now, what I'm showing here is the basic mobility rule. You will find that there's also a more relaxed mobility rule within other panels of IF. But the mobility rule says for European fellowships, the applicants must not have lived or worked in the country of the host organization for more than 12 months in the past 3 years from the deadline. So, September 14, 2017. Let's say you're interested in going to Italy. So you must see in the 3 years before September 14, 2017, in these 3 years, if you have lived or worked in Italy for less than 12 months. If yes, then you are eligible according to the mobility criterion and you can apply. If not, you cannot apply, even if you have a PhD. So it's the two eligibility criteria together, both the experience criterion and the mobility criterion. Now, to calculate these 12 months, you can of course exclude vacations, short stays, visits, etc., etc. Alright? Same rule applies to global fellowships, but for the outgoing country. So if you are, let's say, a Spanish researcher, and you want to do a global fellowship to Japan, then you must make sure that you have not spent more than 12 months the past 3 years in Japan. Okay? So the mobility rule is the same, but for the outgoing host, as we call it in Brussels English, for global fellowships. So this is for European fellowships, this is for global fellowships. Inside the European fellowships, there's three other panels, the career start, the reintegration, and the society and enterprise panel. For those three, there is a more relaxed mobility criterion, which says the same thing, but here it becomes more than 36 months in the past 5 years. Okay? These technicalities are very clear in the guide for applicants, so don't worry. Okay, where do I find them? Participant portal. This is the URL to the participant portal. Even if you forget about it, if you Google it, it's probably the first thing that will pop as a result. If you put EU participant portal Horizon 2020, that's it. Now, there's many ways that you can locate a particular call. I'm presenting to you the one that my brain understands more. I click on this. This shows up. Then I go to funding opportunities. I go to Horizon 2020. Then from Horizon 2020, there is a list here of all the programs. Which programs? Do you remember the map I showed you in my previous talk? There was a map with the different pillars and the programs. Now, you will find all of those by scrolling here. Well, I tick my Sklodowska-Curie reactions. And when I tick it, immediately these three things appear now. There's more things that appear usually in different times, but now these are the open calls, okay? Guess what? I click on Marie Curie Individual Fellowships 2017, of course. And then it takes me here. Topic, you see individual fellowships. By the way, this modus operandi that I'm showing you is also applicable to other European calls and European programs of Horizon 2020, okay? I'm just showcasing now individual fellowships. Now when I go here, then I go to topic, conditions, and documents. Why? Because I need to locate these. These are all useful documents to download and to go through. The most important of these is Guide for Applicants 2017. A must-have document. Download it immediately and study it, don't just read it. Okay, what costs are covered? The financial dimension. I already showed you before the general one, but this is now just for the Marie Curie individual fellowships. So these are the researcher costs, these are the institutional costs. All the money goes to the host institution. The grant is signed between the host institution and the European Commission, but then the researcher gets these amounts per month. Mind you, this is unit cost, this is unit cost, this is unit cost, this is unit cost, this is also unit cost, but it is dependent on the country coefficient of the particular country you go to. So if you go to Italy, you have a different country coefficient multiplied to this number. If you go to France, a different one, etc., etc. Where do I find the country coefficients? Page 71 and 72 of the work program. Hint, hint. Work program. Another document that you must have and you must download. Good? The modalities, as they call them in Brussels English, of the IF call. Now, all the testimonials before were IEF and IIF. This is because they were FP7 modalities. Correct, the three of you? Yes. In Horizon 2020, things have been merged. So we have two basic modalities. The European Fellowships, EF, and the Global Fellowships, GF. Under the European Fellowships, there's also other panels called the Career Start, CAR, the Integration Panel, RI, and the Society and Enterprise Panel, SE. Of most interest to you is probably the reintegration panel for quite a few of you and the EF, Standard European Fellowship. But you might also be interested in Global Fellowship. Okay? So you should know the modalities and how to choose. Now, basic distinction is what? European Fellowship is mobility from Europe or the world to Europe, so to a member state and associate country. Global Fellowships is mobility from Europe to a third country outside Europe and then back again. That sounded like a hobbit, so it's there and back again. All right? From Europe to a third country, not a third world country, be careful, to a third country, and what a third country is defined in the work program, what we mean by abroad of Europe, and then back again. It's an outgoing phase and then a reintegration or a return phase. So the projects here in European Fellowships can last from 12 months to 24 months. Most of you choose 2 years, 24 months. For a Global Fellowship, it can be from 2 years to 3 years. Why? Because it can be from 1 year to 2 years outgoing phase and then absolutely 1 year of a return phase to Europe. Example, Italian researcher starts from Italy, goes to Singapore, comes back to Italy. Allegedly. Okay? Because they start from Europe, they went outside of Europe, and then they came back to Europe. Alright? Spanish researcher goes to the United States and comes back to Germany. Allegedly. Okay? And so on and so forth. Now, I have a specific content for each of the panels. But I haven't done a great job here because it is mainly out of the Guide for Applicants. So to also satisfy the queue a little bit, I will go a bit quicker now because you can anyway read these from the Guide for Applicants and they're not difficult. With the Brussels English that I already translated to you with this past 40 minutes, you should be fine. Okay, so keep in mind there's a reintegration panel, quite a bit of interest for some of you. This has a relaxed mobility rule, and this entails mobility from a third country to a European beneficiary. These are the main key points. Okay, yes, please.
And so is there a if we can choose between the normal panel and the reintegration panel, which one should we try? Is there a difference?
Okay, so the European Commission claims there's a difference in success rate. I would say that there is, that's true, but according to my experience, the differences in the success rates are not that large and that distinctive for you to take that as a hint on where to apply or not. So I would choose whether to apply to a standard European fellowship or an integration panel. I would choose based on how many years you have spent abroad of Europe. So if you're indeed more than 3 or 4 years outside Europe, this would be a better panel for you to submit your proposal to. And that's not written in the rules, but I'm telling you out of experience. Yes, Mathieu, please.
I don't want to make any concurrence towards it. No. What I've heard from other MCPs as well is that indeed the success rate is not that higher for the reintegration panel. However, the
in absolute numbers it is, but that's not too decisive.
Not that
yeah.
much.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But however, the success threshold is lower, which means that a proposal that might not have made it in a normal panel have they have better chance to make it in a reintegration panel, provided, of course, they are eligible to it. It means that you have to have had spent a few years abroad.
I don't know which years I saw the numbers, but the numbers I saw were the opposite, where the threshold was higher for the reintegration panel.
No,
so,
no.
No.
So a proposal of
91.
Relatively maybe a bit lower quality than in the normal panels might made it. And the reason why is that because less people also can apply actually by rule to this panel.
So you're not saying something concurring, but I would, like I said, I would choose based on how many years I've spent abroad or not, if I'm a European researcher. Huh? Okay, so I would choose between the standard European fellowship and the reintegration panel, not based on these technicalities that both of us mentioned, but in a simpler way of thinking. How many years have I spent abroad? If I have indeed made a larger career term abroad, then I would opt for the reintegration. Why? I'm thinking in terms of proposal writing, because I would be able to, sorry again for the verb, to sell it better, that I am reintegrating in Europe. So in the reintegration, I have to prove also what experience and know-how and knowledge I bring from outside Europe back into Europe. Yes, you had a question. Did I cover you? Sorry.
I am for more than 5 years in Japan, so I think that is okay. But my academic position is just the last 2 years, mm-hmm. So does it count? Also, I mean, the years that I was here without academic position can still be.
Yes, so that's not a problem. All right, so allow me to move forward. The Career Star panel. I move forward because it is not of interest to you. I don't think that anyone in here is interested in that as you are now, so I'll skip it. Society and Enterprise Panel. This is under the European fellowships only. This started only in 2016, so it is very, very fresh. It is a modality, a sub-scheme that the European Commission created so as to boost the participation of non-academic organizations in Marie Curie individual fellowships. I think that most of you are interested in a postdoc fellowship in a university. So unless someone feels very strongly about this, I can talk to them during coffee break, otherwise I will skip. Okay? But know it's there. Right, so I continue. You remember the slide, yes? So I went topic and documents, now I go to the submission service. All right, when I hit it, then there's a selection of modalities and panels that you can choose from. All right, I've chosen here standard European fellowship. Why? Because it is the main one, let's say. It is the most popular one. By the way, each year we have about 9,000 to 10,000 applications each year. Most of them are under standard European fellowship. And the success rate for some of you, because I saw some of you were scared, is roughly between 10 to 12, 13%. So the difference, one out of 10, yes, or a bit more, okay? It is highly competitive, I will not lie to you, but it is also highly prestigious, all right? Also quite technical, this is why you need workshops like this, to at least navigate you and translate some of the Brussels English. Now, I've chosen this. What I will describe from now on applies for all of them, actually. So you're not missing out. If you're interested in the integration or global fellowship, you're not going to miss out on something that I say, because what I say now for standard European fellowships, in terms of proposal writing, is valid also for the others, okay? I couldn't present all of them in 1 hour, so, but 99% of the cases are the same in terms of proposal writing, all right? And the template is the same anyway, okay? You okay with that? Good. Ah, but when you hit this, then it comes ECAS. What is ECAS? Now it's called EU login, because in Europe we like to change our bureaucratic titles every time. So it's basically, it's funny that I say this in the EU delegation to Japan. It's basically your credentials, okay? So ECAS stands for European Commission Authentication Service. It is a password and a username. And these are for you, these are personalized, okay? So it's not the same as the PIC number, which is particular to universities and host organizations. The ECAS account is particular to the person, okay, to you. So you log on. If you don't have one, you can create an account over here very easily, okay? And once you do, then this is the proposal preparation interface. This is all done in the participant portal, as you see. These are screenshots from the participant portal that I present to you. All right? Why am I presenting them? Because I know that when you engage into the proposal writing, you would be quite scared with this. So at least you have the slides with Pierantonios to double check if you're going well. Okay? This is my offer to you with these slides. Not because I like screenshots. All right. You need to place here the PIC number, PIC. Participant Identification Code. This is not the ECAS account. This is a 9-digit code particular to the host organization. So, hint, hint. One of the first things that you will discuss with your supervisor is the PIC number of the host organization. She or he needs to locate that from the administration, the research support office or the university, whatever, so that you can have it to actually create the interface of the proposal. All right? Once you enter this, a lot of details, administrative details, are immediately inserted automatically in the submission form part A. Because the part A of the submission form is online, when you introduce the PIC number, there's a lot of administrative technicalities that are filled in automatically because the system recognizes, PIC number such, such, this is Cyprus Institute, okay. It fills in a lot of things. Of course, there's other things in part A that you also have to fill in, but they are personal to you, to your supervisor, etc., etc. So that's a good number to have for many reasons. Down here, I've circled it, but you cannot see it on the screen. You will see it in the slides. This is an email and a telephone number of the technical support service of the participant portal. This is an important piece of information because sometimes you ask from the national contact points information that are technicalities and are glitches on the system. By the way, this happens frequently when you leave things to the last minute. I know researchers don't do that ever. I'm just saying. So, you move further on and you have here your role. I've placed here researcher. Your proposal. Here you have an acronym. What I use now is mock test, okay, so that you get it. And you choose your scientific panel here. And then you have an abstract. The abstract is 2,000 characters, including spaces. Okay, so it's quite an art. These are all messages that you get from the system while you're preparing. I have placed it here exactly because you're going to go back to the office, you start doing this, and then you get all these messages. And you start shaking, oh, something's wrong. No, it's not wrong. So you click OK. Yes, another accept, of course. Continue with this proposal. There you go. Download Part B templates. This is the place where you download the actual Word documents, RTF documents, of the template of Part B where you will actually write the proposal. There's a Part A And there's a part B. Part A is online and is pretty much what you see here with some other additional information. I didn't include screenshots of that because the interface is difficult for me to screenshot. And download part B means you will get the actual part where you write the proposal. Yes?
When I tried to do that, I wanted to skip some pages because I wanted to see what would ask later, but I couldn't save it. So I was wondering, is there some function, or we need to download the stuff, do the part B first, and then when we are ready, do the application in one time?
No, you can, what do you mean save? Well, you should be there. You go to My Proposals, then from the participant portal where you log in again.
I tried just to go to the next pages without filling in all the stuff that were there.
Yeah, the abstract that's fine. You should
I didn't write it, and so I just went to the next page and it said, this is blank, so you can't go farther.
No, I'm confident that you should be able to go back to the other ones and say, because otherwise that would mean that you have get everything right from the first time.
That's
not the case. That must be some sort of technical glitch that I don't know about, but you should be able to return. If not, then you can always delete the proposal and start over. There's absolutely no problem in doing that if, I don't know, nothing works properly. Okay, as long as you have time, to don't leave this to the last to the last minute. But you should be able to go back to the other steps you need, step 3 and step 2 and step 1.
Yeah, I just wanted to save it and work on another.
I would go again to participant portal, My Proposals. You log in with your credentials, EKAS account. You go to My Proposals and you should be able to access it. And like I said, if not, start off. Huh? Because this is quite fast. Okay. I want to make a point here. The template, how the templates look like, you already know from the guide for applicants. Remember, the guide for applicants you can download from the other screenshots, and you can download without logging in with ECAS. But that's a PDF file. But you can already print out and see actually what part B asks you to write. The difference with here is that you actually download a workable document. Okay? Then, edit forms. This is part A. Okay, this is part A. You edit the forms. And for part B, there's two documents, B1 and B2. You should upload in PDF format. And it doesn't stop here. If you want the proposal to be in, you have to hit submit. That's a frequent mistake, especially if you leave things to the last minute. You upload everything, but then you don't hit submit. The proposal is not in. It's there, but it's not in. So validate first, hit the validate, and then hit the submit button. If you do this, let's say, a week before the deadline, but then you choose to change something and you upload again different documents and then you hit submit again, that's fine. The last submit will override the previous one. All right?
Yeah.
That's actually a good hint and tip. Do this at least a couple of weeks before, have a good draft of the proposal inside, and then rewrite and re-edit, okay? All right, I'll try to be as quick as possible here because I also want you to have coffee. Evaluation process is brief. Forget what's there, eyes on me. Now, I will be very quick and I will use broad terms. The evaluation in individual fellowships, roughly, it takes place like this. There's at least three evaluators for each proposal. I would say three. Okay? Three evaluators for each proposal. How are these evaluators chosen? First of all, in your proposal, remember in the screenshots, you had to choose your scientific panel, yes? Now, these are the scientific panels. Chemistry, societal issues, social science and humanities, economics, engineering, environment, life sciences, mathematics, physics. These are broad, of course, scientific panels and fields. There's different things under them. Of course, for the European fellowships, we also have career restart, reintegration, and society. So what happens there? You choose that, if this is of interest, you choose that, and then you are asked to anyway choose a scientific panel. Only the ranking of proposals for these three is interdisciplinary. So if you choose a career star panel, you're competing against archaeologists, nuclear physicists, and chemists at the same time. They are not evaluated by a common committee. They are evaluated by scientists and specialists in each field. But the ranking of proposals is together. The difference with the scientific panels is that these panels, they are all engineering proposals are competing against engineering proposals under the engineering panel. Life sciences proposals are competing against life sciences proposals under the... Clear? Now.
No.
So, no, again. All right. No. You're right. Okay, so under the panels, under the European fellowships, also the global fellowship that I mentioned later, under the European fellowships, you are asked to choose already from the forms the scientific panel you are going to submit your proposal. Why? Because you know what your proposal is. So you will choose out of 8 scientific panels. Which are those? These. Okay? So you know, you are in, what's your field of science? Archaeology, let's say. Okay? If it is archaeology, social sciences and humanities. And I stop there. The rest, forget I told you. They are interdisciplinary panels. The point I made is if you choose one of those panels, because you are eligible or you're interested or whatever, then you also choose a scientific panel for matters of evaluation. But if it confuses you, forget it. Point is, you choose where you submit your proposal in terms of what your scientific field is under one of these 8 broad scientific fields. Okay now?
Yeah.
Beth. I see hand. No. I see ghosts. I see hands. Now, further than that, there's also a set of descriptors that take you, because life sciences is broad enough. You can have biology, you can have someone who is in medicine. So there's also other descriptors that you will choose where, in form A, in part A, that better describe your proposal. The set of descriptors is already found in the guide for applicants from pages 48 to page 63. So by using the descriptors, the scientific panel, and the abstract, you define the keywords of your proposal. Based on those keywords, the scientific panel, the descriptors, and the abstract, the system matches your proposal to profiles of potential evaluators, from where there's a database of experts that has about 60,000 experts now in the commission, and the system matches potential, let's say, CVs, keywords of expertise of these evaluators with the keywords of your proposal. And this is where we choose evaluators from to evaluate your proposal. Parenthesis, hint, hint. Go and subscribe yourself as a potential expert. Where? Participant portal, not funding opportunities, but further to the right, we'll see experts. Go do it. Because you have the credentials and you will potentially be invited, not if you're competing, but in other calls. It's a good thing. And if you are invited as an expert, then you don't need any Pierantonios other, because it's going to be the best training that you will receive in proposal writing, to evaluate proposals. So I close the parenthesis. Go back now. From this matching of profiles with your proposal, 3 are chosen, let's say. Okay? There's always a number 1, number 2, and number 3. This is not hierarchy, but I'll explain. When you are invited as an expert, you are asked, Mr. Pierantonios, for this proposal with this abstract and with these keywords, and can you define yourself how close it is to your expertise? And if you are, this is absolutely my field, I'm right on it, it's number 1. I'm using broad terms, don't misunderstand. If this is not my field completely, but I am a good expert, and I can still do it, you know, very well, it's a number 2. If it is, okay, it's in my broad field, I can do it safely and fairly, but I'm not the expert on it. That's number three. Now, I use this format to explain to you what. For each evaluation, for each proposal, there will be a triplet, three. At least one of them is a number one. At least one of them. This is what the commission says. Now, the others can be two number twos, two number threes, a number two, and a number... At least one is a number one. Why am I saying this for proposal writing workshop? Because you have to... Seconds, is it, or minutes?
Minutes.
Okay. All right. You have to understand that you have to write a proposal, like I said, both for the expert, but also for a bit of a generalist. Don't miss out on details, but don't be extremely, you know, scientific about it. It is a fine balance. Okay? This is the bottom line of the evaluation. I don't want you to spend any more time. I want to give you the evaluation concept of proposals through the prism of proposal writing. Okay? Now follow me. Yes?
You have to choose a panel, but if it's something multidisciplinary?
Good question. If it is something which we want to be multidisciplinary, we want it to be multidisciplinary. And usually we have the cases where a proposal, the scientific field of a proposal is in the boundaries. Okay? There is no actual, let's say, way or recipe to choose. What I would say is you choose the scientific panel within which the descriptors are closer to what you can support as background, as CV, you and your supervisor. I said it again. You will choose to submit the proposal under the scientific panel that for your proposal gives you descriptors that you will use to better support it as a background. Right? Not forgetting that this is career enhancement and further skills, etc., etc. That's the best answer I can give. Do not confuse anyone else. You can ask me more directly if you want during coffee, because that entails a lot of customized look. That's where the national contact points, for example, come in, and the support offices of universities come in, and you discuss specifically, okay, this is IT, or is this engineering? So you have a lot of customized one-to-one, but I don't want to go into detail now, because then it's not a general answer that anyone can be happy with. That was the best answer I could give now. Yes, Mathieu?
Maybe you can just say, because it's not usually 50-50 exactly, so there's usually more of one field than there is of another, and then it should be that one.
True, but I agree with you, but I use the broader terminology that applies to more. I've encountered this question more times than you can imagine, so it is a valid question, but I think this is the best answer I can give to a broad audience. All right, how are things scored? There's an excellence part, an impact part, and an implementation part. 50% of the mark, this is the science part, but not only. There's also training inside, the supervisor profile is inside, so there's quite a few things. 50% of the grade. 30% of the grade is impact to your career, and impact to European added value. Aha, things start coming into proximity. And implementation, how are you going to do these things? 50, 30, 20. You do not have the luxury to leave something behind. You must address all of them and address them well. So these 20% out of 100% is very valuable. Don't disregard implementation. 30% of the impact, even more valuable. Don't disregard it. 50%, I am more comfortable with that because I know you're researchers and you know your science. But you don't feel comfortable with this 50%. Don't disregard it. Don't just write your science there. You need also the other parts. And you need them written in a nice Brussels English way. This is how things are scored, from 0 to 5, and there's halves in between. This is what excellence, impact, and implementation look like in individual fellowships. So under excellence, this is 1, 2, 3, this is 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, and so on and so forth. These are the subsections of Part B, Template Section 1. okay? This is the first document of Part B, Section 1. 1, 2, 3, and accordingly. These are the titles of the questions that you have to answer when you write your proposal. I will come to this later on, but yes, you go ahead.
I'm just wondering if you can ask questions about particular points. I have a question in one point.
I'd like you to wait a little bit until the other session, and if we are over today and I haven't answered what you might want to ask now, then you can approach me. Because I have three other slides later, I don't want to waste this. Later, please. All right, this is where the evaluation takes place. Don't ask me why I have the picture. Okay. All right. I will be quick because I think you're tired and I'm not tired and I need a break and you need coffee. So interactive evaluation exercise. I'll be quick, but please pay attention. Be patient with me just a bit more. What do I want you to get out of the exercise? I will ask you to read with me. I will read with you. Real evaluation comments, so the remarks of evaluators for two actual real proposals. They're both Cypriot, so I have the right to show them, and I asked for their permission, so don't worry. And they are anonymized anyway. But we will read together what you need to take either as actual notes or mental notes. The Brussels English, and the points of attention. What did the evaluators notice, both as strengths and as weaknesses? Okay? And put that into the prism of the policy background I was talking to you in the beginning. This is the scope of your exercise, okay? Let's go. Now, the excellence part of proposal X. Strengths. The proposal provides a good overview of the main objectives of the project. There's bibliographical references, there's a good research and complementary training plan. Brussels English. Research and complementary training plan. Indicating for each activity the relevance of the host and the supervisor. Okay, so why they are able to do it? Why are they the best hosts and supervisors to do what to you? Boost and enhance your career perspective. The project describes well how the knowledge previously acquired by the researcher will be transferred to the host. The proposal demonstrates well high qualification and experience of the supervisor. They were interested in that. Okay. They provide information on the research field, the main research project, international collaborations and publications, mobility, networking. The proposal describes clearly the hosting arrangements in place, charter and code. Excellent working conditions. Both Tom and I showed you the slide with key features. You remember that? The key features? One of the things was attractive working conditions. Hello, attractive working conditions and what you should provide to showcase how the host has attractive working conditions for you. This is section 1.3. Hosting arrangements. And this guy's got it. The proposal demonstrates a good match between the applicant's profile and the research topic. By the way, these are expressions that you can use in your proposal. If the evaluators have to write with this Brussels English, why can't you? Example, under section, what is it, 1.4, which is the maturity of the applicant for mature career conditions. You start by saying, this proposal well demonstrates that there's a good match between the applicant. You see? <I'm joking. laughs> You think I am, but, you know, paraphrase, of course. Eh? Don't just copy and paste, because then we'll have 20,000 the same applications. But you get the point. Eh? If you read through the documents that I suggested, you will inevitably start writing like that, because you need to showcase how you match, how you address all those individual fellowships requirements. Weaknesses. The proposal does not describe in detail the interdisciplinary aspects. So they are interested in interdisciplinary aspects. These guys just didn't make it. How much do you think it got? Shoot numbers.
Four.
Four.
Three and a half.
Three and a half.
4.5.
4.5. More than 4.5. 4.8. Okay. Excellence part of another proposal. Let's call it Y or Y or Epsilon, okay? This proposal tackles an innovative, interesting, timely and policy relevant question. Russell's English, keep that in mind. Timely and relevant. I will remind you in another slide. State of the art is adequately indicated. The project provides the applicant with new knowledge through training, and this is well addressed and convincing. Why was it convincing to them? Because the proposal was talking about skills such as proposal writing, high quality research papers, interview skills, programming, training, etc. Nice ideas. The transfer of knowledge by the researcher to the host is also well formulated. The supervising scientist has extensive experience in industry and academia and a strong track record of publications. The applicant, look at this. This is sometimes I get questions like this, and this is the answer. The applicant earned a PhD recently and has not had the time to publish. But this was not against her. It's a she, by the way. The applicant reveals good capacity to reach or reinforce a position of professional maturity in research. Full Brussels English sentence. Yes.
In the last few contradict each other, has strong track record of publications, but it says, but the applicant earned PhD degree. Oh, the supervisor is,
Okay. I was going to the best thing. Weaknesses. No sufficient elements to judge whether the methodology to be followed would be appropriate for such a demanding task. The research methodology will be, this is strictly scientific. What does it tell you? You see, there's comments about the actual science part. This is too technical for me to understand what they meant. The rest you can comment, you can understand. It's normal Brussels English. But this was, what does this tell you? Both the science and the non-scientific parts are important. You score in all of them. Hosting arrangements are not presented in sufficient detail. You remember the previous one? Hosting arrangements were excellent. So they do pay attention to these things. It's just that one of them got it right and the other one didn't. But bottom line is they pay attention. Independent thinking and leadership qualities. How much do you think this got?
Three. Four.
Let's see. 3.7. Okay? Point being, there's a high level of subjectivity, okay? It's not that you're not getting it right, because some of you are more strict than others, some of you come from stricter or less strict disciplines, it's normal. Huh? So the three people that were scoring, they scored like this, okay? And they had the full proposal in front of them, you just have a paragraph, so that's different. Impact. These are the same proposals, eh? The same two proposals, only I go with different sections. Impact. The proposal clearly describes the impact of research and training on the researcher's career. I couldn't put it in a better way, in a simpler way. The proposal includes a good plan for advertising research activities and results to the wider public. How many of you remember that Tom mentioned that? Science communication, outreach, public engagement. This is all European taxpayer money. We have to show to them that we're not doing it just for our career. This is also for them. Hint, hint. This is part of your why. You're not just doing it for your money. You're doing it for a deeper cause. Yes, please.
Are there any good resources where we can learn how we can access this? Because that's the part which we as scientists will have.
Patience. You will see until the end of the day. And if not, I will be available to you. But I think I will answer that question. Like I said, you have to be patient with me because I do this in a particular way. I will take you there. Bear with me. Because I'm also enjoying this, so you have to let me do it my way. Weaknesses. The researcher provides a good dissemination plan to the specialized public. Hint, hint. We talk about two different things then. It is one section, dissemination, but it's two different audiences, you see. Dissemination, specialized public. What goes under dissemination? Events, publications, papers, conferences. But then there's also communication and outreach. That's different. That's to the wider public, to the non-specialists. TV, radio, articles, blogs, researcher's night of Marie Curie, these things. Weaknesses. The proposal does not describe how exploitation of results and intellectual property will be managed. So that's another issue you need to be careful about and to describe how you're going to do it. What do you think? Mark?
4.5.
4.5. Going once, going twice. 4.7. Okay? Same for Ypsilon. Let's see. The project has the potential to allow the researcher to reach the next stage of academic career by publishing in good level journals and developing very interesting and relevant research agenda. The amount and width of the activities related to dissemination is remarkable. Look at the word, remarkable. Why is it remarkable? We explain. They have classic as well as electronic dissemination channels. They have researchers' nights, TV and radio interviews, web-based outreach, FameLab competitions, Marie Curie Project Open Day, articles in newspapers, web-based outlets, and they are all excellent in how she described. That's another she, two ladies in this proposal. Exploitation of results is excellent. The management regarding the intellectual property that may arise from the research project is described in detail. No significant weaknesses. What do you think is the grade? Close enough. Close enough. Implementation. I'm done. Then we can go to break. Implementation. For the X. Look at this wonderful Brussels English. The overall coherence of the work plan is good. Overall coherence of the work plan. A Gantt chart and an adequate description of the work package is provided with milestones and deliverables. The appropriateness of the management structure and procedures, including mentoring activities and financial management, is there. The proposal explains about the appropriateness of the research facilities. Research facilities, research infrastructure, resources. All these facilities and infrastructure guarantee the fellowship a maximum chance of successful outcome. The applicant describes the commitment of the beneficiary to the program. Also, look at this. Also in the perspective of a future development of the research project post-mortem, after the end of the fellowship. Continuity, sustainability. You don't have to promise that they will hire you immediately after the 2 years, but maybe it's a good thing to mention if they can hint towards that. They can say that we're very much interested in this fellow. We have commitment of this fellow. If she or he brings a competitive European fund like Marie Curie Individual Fellowship, we're interested in keeping her or him. At least express the interest. Or showcase how you could potentially continue your research even after the Marie Curie Fellowship. The Marie Curie Fellowship has to be the first solid starting point, but the starting point. Then you can start discussing about the ERC starting grant, or another Marie Curie Fellowship, or other national funds of the particular host, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All leading to where? To a more mature career in research after the fellowship. So don't forget about sustainability issues of the fellowship itself. Weaknesses. The distribution of activities throughout the calendar is unclear. Therefore, it makes them feel a bit awkward as the evaluators. And the proposal does not provide a contingency plan. So another thing that they pay attention to, the supervisor, the host, the profile of the host and the supervisor, hosting arrangements, resources, infrastructure. These are the things that they pay attention. And then they start paying attention to impact issues like dissemination, but also wide outreach and communication, intellectual property rights management, and exploitation of results. And now you have a new one, contingency plan. Risk assessment. What would go wrong in the proposal and what we will do to avoid it? What do you think? 4.5. You're tired. Okay, I get the point. It's 4.2. Alright? Last but not least. So we went through the entire part B of two proposals. The work packages are very well formulated. The Gantt chart includes the deliverables and the milestones of the project. And it is detailed. But it does not describe appropriately the first work package, which is project management training and outreach activities. The project management arrangements, management structure, and the progress monitor mechanisms are credibly discussed. Risks that might be there and contingency plans are very well formulated. Convincing examples and details about the risk management are provided. Excellent. The institutional environment and infrastructure are appropriate. The benefits of the fellowship for the researcher are described in detail. The commitment is sufficiently demonstrated. Now look at the weaknesses. This one correlates to this one. What did she do? First of all, she didn't listen to me. When I saw the proposal, I told her, work package one is too big. You have put under one. Yeah, yeah, but it's okay. It's not my science work package. Rule number one, you have 50, 30, and 20%. Everything matters, not just the 50%. So she disregarded intentionally the implementation part because she thought these guys are going to be interested about the science. That's okay. I will put all the bureaucratic stuff in one work package. This work package is too big to have project management, training. This is your fellowship about career training and outreach activities. She put all in one. Guess what happened 5 months later when she got the results? The evaluators told her, Pierantonios was right. Well, not exactly like that. But they were saying the same thing as I did to her. Huh? This could be work package one, this could be work package two, and this could be work package three. Not all in one work package. Because they told her here, the wide variety of activities in work package one is likely to decrease the time dedicated to basic research. What happened? They misunderstood. Because work package one was so large, they misunderstood what? She's going to be doing only that and not research. And she wanted to show them exactly the opposite, that she will be doing more research and less bureaucracy. Okay? So, basic hint and tip here from the SCP is what? Huh? You break down nicely your activities. Throw in an extra work package, it doesn't matter, because anyway, in the Gantt chart, you're going to be showing how these things are interrelated. Yes?
I missed what is the definition of
work package. Okay. This is project management 101. I'm not joking. This is when you have a project to finish up, this is broken down in different, let's say, packages of activities. You have your scientific technical activities that you have to perform. But then you have also other things that constitute a nice management of the project, a nice running. The administration, both in terms of, let's say, paperwork and logistics, is one thing. So that would be work package one, project management. The activities of disseminating, of communicating, of making the conferences, of going to conferences, of making a blog, that's not scientific technical work, but it's still part of the project. That would be a different package of work. The dissemination or communication package. Then, particularly for individual fellowships, you also have training activities. That still is not science and technically what you're doing, but it's still part of the project. That's a different package of activities, so another work package, which would be the training and development work package. The rest of the things that your science, or what you will be technically doing, break it down to your research objectives. Each research objective should have a work package dedicated to it. So if you have two or three, let's say, research objectives, I would expect two or three technical scientific work packages. So I just described to you a project with six work packages. Okay? Good. All right. What do you think she got?
Four.
Because they were impressed, you remember? They were impressed with the five of the impact. But still, they found that it didn't blind them. I would have given less, first of all, because she disagreed with me. So. But they gave four, but that was the maximum they could actually give. Because the layout of how she was going to implement the project was not. All right, overall, the Ypsilon proposal, 3.7 in excellence, 5 in impact, 4 in implementation, she got an 83. Why a member? This is 50%, 30%, 20%. She didn't get funded. This was an economics proposal. Irrelevant, I'm just telling you. X proposal. She got 4.8 in excellence, 4.7 in impact, 4.2 in implementation. She got a 93 and she just made it through. This was an archaeology proposal, by the way. She got funded. I purposely chose also from different fields so that you... Yeah. All right. Shall we? All right. And if you know what this is, please raise your hands. The survivor's guide here. Just a few. Okay, I'm happy. So this is something that I've... And this is not boasting. Please don't take it like that. But this is something that I first wrote in 2014. After doing the pre-screening and proposal writing support as a national contact point for a few years, and every time I had different researchers and they were asking for this or asking for that, and then I would send them, oh, to answer your question, please find attached these two documents, and to answer the different question, please find attached these other documents, and then it hit me. So why don't I prepare a guide where everything is going to be in? And that didn't save me for questions, it created more. But it's all there, at least. I will help them in a tangible way. And this is what happened. I prepared it as a Cypriot national contact point. This was just for Cyprus. But it apparently was so well accepted that colleagues, NCPs from the other countries were asking, can you send it to us? Yeah, of course, it's no problem. It worked. It was well received from the community. I had uploaded it in my ResearchGate profile, and I had like 800 downloads in a week, so I said, okay, must be interesting. Then I prepared a better one in 2015, same case, even more, and then eventually we decided as NCBs, why don't we do it as a European thing? So I wrote again the basic part, most of it, and then I sent it to my colleagues throughout Europe, NCBs like me, and they reviewed and added, so we made it not only a secret thing, but a common thing, which anyway it was helping people all over. And this is the European Net for Mobility, as you see, Survivor's Guide. Now what it is, you go online to Net for Mobility, you will find it, it is for free, it is a PDF, I think it's 46 pages, and I claim it translates a lot of the Brussels English into human. Quite a few people agree with me. There's quite a few people within the commission that agree with me as well. But seriously, this has made a blast because it's a bit funny, so it is, you know, it's looser, it is not in jargon, and it helps you understand in a more, let's say, human and less bureaucratic way what the call wants you to do. And I'm not just saying it because, you know, I first prepared it in 2014. From the result, it shows that it worked. So it's out there for you. I don't think there will be a 2017 version, but this is still quite valid. So I think 99% of the stuff in there is quite valid. Some of the things in there are also valid, not only for Marie Curie, not only for individual fellowships, but also for other things. For example, I have 6 pages of a glossary at the end explaining jargon, like what is a big number? There. What is an NS account and how do I get it? Is there? So there's also those things. Plus the what it is known for, it goes section by section and subsection by subsection and provides strategy approach and even some text sometimes. And then which you can use, try to paraphrase, don't just copy paste, but it's there for it is a nice unofficial guide, okay? Bottom line. And it has helped quite a few people. So go online and find it, Google it, or go even better, netformobility.eu, and you will find it under NCP's documents. And I can send it to you if you want. And that's the good alternative to stealing past proposals. Because there have been a serious number of past proposals that have been written based on this. So it's a good alternative. But in any case, if I have to comment on that, it's a good practice to try and locate past proposals. Usually that happens through the university that you are applying with, and some of the organized universities, they have organized proposal support offices, and they keep track of their proposals, both successful and unsuccessful. You can try the national contact points, but I will be very careful with what I say now. There's still confidentiality issues. So even for me to include things in the exercise that I showed you, I anonymized the proposal, and I asked for permission from the two ladies to include parts of it. So you can ask the national contact point. Doesn't mean that you will not get it. But again, there's a lot of confidentiality issues. Okay? But then you have colleagues, you have people you know, you have testimonials here today, and there's sources and sources to find past proposals, both successful and unsuccessful. And always use with care. Because like I said, this is customized. This is your career development. So what worked or didn't work for Pierantonios doesn't necessarily mean it will work or not work for your case. Okay? This is about past proposals because this is a usual question I get. But survivor's guide, I think, is a good enough guide. It's one of the things that you print and you have under your pillow for all the period of, all the period of proposal preparation. Okay. Next to the guide for applicants. So it's the two things that you print. And I had a testimonial 2 years ago, again, in a workshop like this, and I had somebody saying, well, the best thing you can do is to have a printed version of Pierantonios. And you have it. It's Survivor's Guide. So everyone was laughing. Survivor's Guide is there for you. Download it. It's useful. But there's other useful things as well. Over your overall useful links, and the Horizon 2020 help desk, the Horizon 2020 online manual, a lot of information there about cross-sectional issues, gender balance, research ethics. There's a lot of things in there, not only for that, but it's a good source of information. You can find a lot of information, especially about the policy issues, the policy background, all that Brussels English, as I called it, in the Euraxess library. This is the link. And what's better is that Euraxess has it organized. So in terms of official documents, studies, researches, policy documents, white papers, etc., etc. And it is all about research mobility, research careers, European research area, innovation union, etc., etc. So it is extremely pertinent to a proposal for Marie Curie individual fellowships. Okay? You will also find the charter and code there, the European Charter for Researchers, the Code of Conduct for Recruitment Researchers. All these policy documents can be found in bullet point format, downloadable format in the Euraxess policy library. So go check it. I mean, it's a good URL to have. And then you're not looking around for things and policy issues. All the policy background is there. Okay? You wouldn't have to download a lot of things. Browse through a lot of things. Doesn't necessarily mean you will read 3,000 pages of policy. But you, at least you must get the feeling of what is there. And now you have a guide to do it, because you already saw what I was picking, in my slides, and then you will see also the same things in the survivor's guide when you download. So you're not shooting all over the place, even within here. Then there's another thing I want to point you to. It's the annotated model grant agreement. Be careful, there's a new version every approximately 6 months. The latest one is the one of April 21st, 2017. That's the model of the grant you will be signing with the Commission. It has all the articles inside of the grant. And now you might ask, okay, so why is this useful for me for proposal writing? Because this is about 700 pages. And you can see this only for individual fellowships. This is pages 438 to 469. So why is this useful to me, Pierantonios? First of all, because it is the model grant that you will be signing after you win the proposal. So in that grant, you will see all the articles, therefore all the requirements that they will have for you, if you have a grant. So if you have it as a knowledge already from now, don't you think maybe it's useful for your Brussels English and all the things that you need to show that you will address in the proposal? Yes, it is. Plus, it's annotated. Means what? It has annotations. It has examples and clarifications on the content of the articles. From whom? From the Commission itself. Did I convince you now? Good. GIP for applicants, another one of those things that you print and you have below your pillow. It is the guide for applicants for the individual fellowships. You download it from the participant portal and you read through it carefully, very carefully. It's about 65 pages and it contains everything you must know about individual fellowships, plus it contains drafting instructions for the proposal. So how to write part A, how to write part B, it contains a template of part B, it contains the descriptors, everything that we have been telling since this morning. Okay? Of course, another must-have document is the survivor's guide. This is a glimpse of part B, section 1, part B1 and part B2. There's a page limit here. There's no page limit here per se, but you will see that there's, let's say, internal page limits. Part 1 is excellence, impact, and implementation. Part 2 is the CV, a table for the capacities of the organization, ethical aspects, and then only for global fellowships, only for global fellowships, letter of commitment for the partner organization. I'll translate it to human English. In a global fellowship, you have two entities. The host organization, which is always the European university, to speak plainly, but then, because global fellowship is about what? It's about mobility to a third country and then back again. You need the host also in the third country. In Brussels English of Marie Curie, we call that a partner organization. So the beneficiary for a global fellowship is the European university. The partner organization is the foreign, let's say, university. America, Canada, Japan, wherever it is, the outside of Europe university, all right? You need a letter of commitment from that university to be included in the proposal. This is only for global fellowships, only. The rest, they stop at section 6. Clear? Clear. And you see there's very strict guidelines on the length of things. You can find these in the drafting instructions of the guide for applicants. I showed you already. So it tells you the start page must be one whole page. It's in the template. Follow it. Table of contents, same thing. List of the organization, same thing. Then you have section 1, section 2, and section 3. These three together must be 10 pages maximum. Okay? And then you see the rest. This is just, as you can see, this is copy and paste from the template, so I haven't touched anything there. Now, a bit of deciphering of Brussels English into human English. I like this joke a lot. Three slides. If you leave with nothing else today, please leave with these three slides. Now, until a couple of years ago, this was my main punchline of the workshop. Because myself and some other people became, let's say, part of the task force that supported the European Commission in better drafting the guides for applicants, these things have been included now as requirements in the guide for applicants. But nonetheless, I will make a punchline. So, left-hand side is what is required for excellence. You remember the table I showed you before? Okay. This is Brussels English. This is human English. Okay? Same goes for impact. This is Brussels English, this is human English. Same goes for implementation. Brussels English, human English. And this is the point where I explain what I mean. People who think, who can understand what coherence and effectiveness of the work plan actually means, huh? Okay, well it means, give us work packages, give us a list of deliverables, so tangible outputs, give us a list of milestones, so goal points, yes or no. Put it all in a Gantt chart, okay? Plot it. Plot it in a Gantt chart, again. Describe how the work plan goes, progress monitoring, etc., etc. Same goes with the other things. Quality of the proposed measures to exploit and disseminate the action. Well, it means dissemination of the research results. And by dissemination, we understand what? Conferences, papers, journals, etc., etc. But also exploitation of results in intellectual property. So this is the part where you write about IPR. This is the part where you need to contact the host organization and see from their patent office, if they have one, or their research support office, more generically, what their approach to IPR is. What your approach to IPR is. Do you need to educate yourselves on what IPR is? Yes, you do. How do you do that? Well, I have more on IPR management. IPRhelpdesk.eu. This is a European entity. Go and check what exploitation of research results is according to the European Union. And guess what? They have a fact sheet which is particularly IP management for Mandatory Horizon 2020. Download it. It's a good document. More on exploitation and dissemination results. There you go. I start answering your question. Huh? Outreach and communication activities. That's a good document over there. With suggestions and yes, is it TV and radio? Yes. Is it articles? Yes. Is it participation to researchers night? Yes. Is it Marie Curie Open Day? Yes. But not only that. You don't just write, oh yeah, I will participate, I will do a Marie Curie Open Day. So? No. Do you remember one of the ladies, she got remarkable? You remember that word? Why? Because she explained, I will have a Marie Curie Open Day. Tick. It says it here. But not only that. She said, I would expect this to this many people. They would be of this and this level of knowledge. I would tell them about Marie Curie, about the funding of the European Union, how it affected my career. I would tell them also about my science to try to promote more. And I would make clear why it is of use also to the public. And then I would test their reaction by a simple questionnaire. It's testing anonymous, what they knew before, and how they feel now after my presentation. Full marks. Does that ring a bell? The questions that they were given to the three testimonials today, they were not by chance. These are the things that we want to see in public engagement dissemination. I have a question over there.
So is it also where we discussed about open access?
Yes.
Open access publication.
Data management, open access, etc., etc.
Yeah.
Exactly. There's many things that is exploitation of results. Most people think, oh, patents, I don't have patents in archaeology. It's not just patenting. Exploitation of research results, it is not just patenting. Please go to IPR Helpdesk and you will see that there's different versions and ways of exploitation of research results. Educate yourselves on that, and then you will be able to see what is pertinent for you and what you can do, what you can write in the proposal, where? In section 2, here. Alright? Did I answer your question? Alright. Section 1, training. It says at some point you have to provide a concrete training plan through research and about complementary or transferable skills. This is what they call it in Brussels English. Usual question. Pierantonios, what is a complementary transfer? It's soft skills. Not necessarily correlated to a particular scientific field. For example, a training on project management doesn't really matter whether you are a nuclear scientist or an archaeologist. It makes you a better scientist and a better researcher, though. Proposal writing for competitive EU grants doesn't matter if you are a biologist or an epidemiologist. But it makes you a more holistic researcher because you know how to write competitive grants. So that kind of skills, and I present here a set of examples. Not everything is for everyone. But there's definitely something for you. And you have to make sure that it is pertinent to you. So for example, when I finish my PhD and I write a proposal for Marie Curie, that's Pierantonios. Do you think I'm going to put up, oh, I need training on proposal writing? No, because I've done this for 10, 15 years. So it's not pertinent to me. You see what I mean? So I'm not going to write there something because it looks nice or because somebody told this is a nice skill to promise. No, it has to be skills that are pertinent to you. As Pierantonios, I don't need project management training and I don't need proposal writing training because I think I know. Huh? But I need other things. Maybe you need one of the soft skills is proposal writing. Or one of the soft skills could be interview skills for tenureship positions. And I want to see that skill, your training at the end of your fellowship. So this is also what it means to matter in the Gantt chart. So in the Gantt chart, you promise your trainings and things have to make sense. Does it make sense that when you're finishing the 2 years, you got all the skills, you got the grant, you did everything, now you're proposing a skill? Okay, I need to do something after the fellowship. So I will be trained also in interview skills to seek for permanent jobs in academia. By the way, this was one of the part of the remarkable that she got, because she was promising her interview skills at the end of the fellowship. It makes sense. Also, it has to make sense what skills you choose according to your profile. But in any case, this is a quite extensive list of potential skills, because I always got the question, give us a few examples. So there's a few examples there. For more, look at Euraxis Career Development. There's service centers of Euraxis that do that. And from what I know, the project of Euraxis also will put together a list of skills, of crucial skills for researchers. But in any case, there's also the National Postdoctoral Association of the United States that has a list of competencies. And then there's also UK VITA that also has skills of professional development of researchers. This is the same concept. Okay? You will find these URLs also in Survivor's Guide. So I think we have covered potential skills that you could see and find appropriate for yourself. Then there's ethics and research. This is section 6 of Part B. You can find a lot of things with the HTTP online manual. Same about gender. Some of you are particularly interested. Again, HTTP online manual. And remember, this was one of my first slides that I showed you the useful links. In the same slide as the annotated model of agreement, I have the HTTP online manual. It is a good source anyway of information. Guidance on how to complete your ethics self-assessment. A usual misconception is that the ethics part is only for the life sciences where they have biology and cells and things like that. No. It's not only about tests on humans and tests on animals. There's quite a few notions. Okay, so go check online, educate yourself from the H2020 online manual what is considered as ethics in research and how you should address it. Okay, so another useful URL. And of course, research risk-benefit analysis and guidance for contingency planning, risk management, etc., etc. All URLs there, not ancient wisdom, I'm just reproducing. I'm pointing you, I'm signposting, flagging some of the useful URLs. This is just copy-paste from Part B 2, so Section 4, the CV. I'm putting it here because I want to explain to you that this list of 10 things is not enforced. So many people have the misconception, oh, I see it in the guide for applicants, I see it in the template, I don't have prizes and awards, and I don't have granted patents. Does that mean I think? No. This is a list of things that they would like to see included in the CV. Whatever is pertinent for you. Parenthesis. Of course, the more the merrier. It shows that you are a very competent researcher. But do not worry if you don't have a patent, for example. Okay? This is just a list of examples that reflects your track record. So when you see this, and you will see this in the guidelines, don't be afraid that you have to answer to each of the 10 points. Okay? And now just a copy of what you've done already. So common errors. Yes, the proposal is written as a scientific paper. Okay? Because you are scientists and you're researchers, you like to write more about the state of the art, but then you forget about the non-science bits. You don't care. That's okay. Sometimes the NCP tells you that you don't listen to the NCP. And then you get remarks from the evaluators, oh, but work package one was too large. Unclear aims and objectives. It is over-ambitious, or undershooting, I would also tell you. It is not enhancing the training or the career, which is the basic philosophy of individual fellowships. The CV is not properly presented, or not matching Part A. So be careful what you're writing in Part A online, and what you're presenting then in the CV. Things should be matching.
okay? Also in terms of eligibility. Yeah? Off-page limits. Ha ha ha, how is it possible? It is very possible. You can't imagine the things I've seen in these past 10 years. And I always said, it is 10 pages, follow it. Yes, but I wrote a paragraph, I don't care. 10 pages. No, no, but they will, no. 10 pages. Okay? You laugh and you nod your heads, but I'm sure I will see some more this year. Follow the template. Seriously. Write an answer to everything. Don't disregard any parts. Oh, this is the ethics section. I don't have ethics. No. Provide good and complete answers, educated answers to all of them. How are they going to be educated? And I presented, I think, over 50 URLs in my slides. go and take a look at those URLs. So you provide good, complete Brussels English answers to every section, because every section counts. Don't do things at the last minute, because you will end up sending wrong drafts. And I'm not joking, this has happened more than once. I had people sending in wrong drafts at the end and wasting 4 months of attempts. Why? Because they did the submission at the last minute, although they had prepared well. So go acquaint yourself with the system, with the participant portal. It is not scary. It used to be worse. Now it is much better. It is a very complete system, the participant portal. And I would say it's quite user-friendly, but educate yourself on it. Play a little bit around how you will make the proposal, how you will delete it, how you will go back to step one. Play yourself a bit. What the evaluators expect? All of you are in academia. I mean, you have corrected exam papers, test papers, you have reviewed proposals. You always expect it is natural. Things to be flowing, to be well-written, to be concise, to be coherent, to be interconnected. No typos. No clear English. The proposal has to be built around the criteria so it helps them score it. Something that flows, that uses the nice and the proper wording. It is always easier to read. It was mentioned also there. Help them read it well. They don't have too much time. Remember, each of them, they belong to 10, 15, even more triplets. You remember, there are three evaluators for every proposal. In one case, you could be number one, but you could be also number two or number three in other proposals. But in any case, you get a number of proposals, not just one, two, or three. So help the evaluators read through your proposal and help them understand why it addresses both the science and the career development and the policy issues. Make it easy for them. Focus on the career development of the researcher. Give a clear description and a structure of the training program. Showcase the value and the quality of the supervision. Tell them that you have plan B. This is research. We know things don't go as planned always, but we also need to know that the money is invested in good hands. So you know what could possibly go wrong, and we need you to tell us how you will mitigate any adversity. Intellectual property right management, outreach and dissemination plans, no duplications and copy-pastes from previous things. Use tables and diagrams which should be relevant, not just a copy-paste of an image from elsewhere. So don't use these that I have here. And it should be understandable. This is the image and the table and the diagram accompanying this part of the text. Guess what? Use the structure and the table of contents from the templates. Use the titles and the subtitles from the templates. Use the margins, the font size, the numbering, and the page limits from where? From the templates. Yeah, you laugh, but okay. It is the drafting instructions of Part B in the guide for applicants. Yes, sir, please. Is there what? For physicists and chemists like that, you mean?
Letters.
Yes, I know. They usually use it in physics, mathematics, and chemistry. No. I know. That's a good question. And we have posed it to the European Commission, actually. Latex is, or LaTeX, or how you call it, is for those of you who are not physicists and chemists and mathematicians. And you write in code pretty much, and then the outcome is in PDF, if I'm not mistaken, or it could be in PDF. It makes their life with equations and that a lot easier. No, there is not that template.
We don't like the formatting is left for the.
At least you not
have to put that.
You have to. So you have to make sure. I actually know people, and I've worked with people who were doing this, and we wrote a proposal together. There is a way to give an instruction to LaTeX to make the margins that are there. So in the drafting instructions, you will find minimum font size and minimum margins that are designed for what? Okay, that was a good question. If you are using that system, it's a bit tougher for you, but you have to follow it. Anyway, I know I've worked with mathematicians and physicists, and it's a pain, but you have to be able to codify in a way that it will come out with the margins that are set, so 15 millimeters all around, single line spacing, and aerial over Times New Roman is the preferable. Yes?
A comment on this. A friend of mine who has done this kind of numeric reactions,
mm-hmm.
I contacted him because he told me that there are Latin templates for this.
Now, available?
I don't know from the commission.
It's not from the commission.
Maybe, at least he told me that he found one.
It's not from the commission, but I'm pretty sure.
Official, maybe there are.
And like I said, I know people, I've worked with people who have done that, so if you need the code or whatever. But the drafting instructions are there, are in the guide for applicants, you should follow them. Okay, yes?
Before we can download the Part B template, do we need to fill all the things in the Part A, or we can do it?
No, it was a question also before, you can do it separately, but at the end, you must make sure you hit the validate button so that you make sure that everything is filled in part A and that you have all the documents uploaded from part B, and then you hit the submit button. Okay? Yes?
About the maximum limit of 10 pages, how short is too short?
There's no magic and there's no good answer to that. I'll answer in a different way, because that's usually another question. I got this question usually in the beginning of Horizon 2020 because I had a lot of people who remembered FP7. Now, in FP7, it was 30 pages, not 10 pages, and the Commission was also telling particularly for each section the page limit. So for the science section was 10 pages. Not now, not here. So you see it's 10 pages for both the excellence and the impact and implementation. So a usual question is, how do I distribute those 10 pages? There's no real answer, and the answers are dangerous, usually. But I'm a dangerous person, so in the survivor's guide, I have made four alternative suggestions. They are suggestions. Don't take them literally. And I said, it's 5-3-2, it's 3-4-3, it depends. But in any case, it can be 3.5 and then 2.5, whatever. But in any case, if you need to take a note of what I say now verbally. My experience has shown that for the excellence part, you cannot use less than 4 pages to be able to properly cover. For the implementation part, I wouldn't go with less than 3 pages. So do your math. What leaves? Can it be 4.5 kilotons? Yes, it can. Can it be 2.5? Yes, I don't care. It is your proposal, your recipe. It is 10 pages. That's what you have to follow. But I've risked a further suggestion just to guide you through. Most people would say, so it's 50%, 30%, 20%. Do I go 5-3-2? No is my answer, because you will never make it 2 pages with implementation. For implementation to be properly written and score all the 20%. Okay? So I think no less than 4 pages for excellence, no less than 3 pages for implementation, and the rest for impact. But again, this I say as a hint of and tip from my experience. It's not written something in stone, and it is okay if you follow something else. Okay, yes, please.
Regarding the figures for each subsection, one figure or how many figures?
With figures, you mean images and.
Yes.
as many as they make sense. I would say always don't overdo it.
But for because example, what is it? For example, for each section of excellent, one figure, or what is the cost?
No, usually I have seen more figures in the excellence part. Because it is the science part, and there's people who need actually a couple of images or a table or a figure in the science part. I usually see figures and tables and images, photos, in the excellence part. Not in impact, unless it's a diagram or whatever, and even less in implementation, because in the implementation part, you anyway have the Gantt chart, which is a figure. It is a table. Where you plot, and sometimes you even have a path diagram, so how the work packages are interrelated. Yeah, I'm almost done with it. So I don't have a clear recipe for that. It depends also on the science, on your approach. I would always say don't overdo it, and you will find yourself that 10 pages it's narrow. So you might sacrifice, in the end, some images if you are to make your point clear. Yes?
I'm just answering my question. My question was if the figures count as page space.
Everything counts as page space. This is why I make a point of use margins, font size, numbering in the templates. Follow the drafting instructions of the guide for applicants. When you will open it, you will download the link, you will see that they are very detailed. They tell you minimum font size 11. Arial or Times New Roman preferable. The minimum font size for footnotes is 8. The same for tables. References, bibliographical references, must go in the footnotes. And they are included in the overall page count. They are very detailed. This is why I have a good laugh when I see things going on. Because they are very detailed and they tell you exactly what to do. Follow it, please. Because otherwise you will get hopefully corrected in the pre-screening. If not, it makes a problem in the evaluation. You will not be rejected for that, but you might score less. So it's not an eligibility criterion to submit the proposal, but that definitely scores less. Okay, consider cross-cutting issues, gender, open data, ethics, societal aspects, just for you that gender part, this is the Horizon 2029 manual. No emphatic statements, okay, no typos, no inconsistencies, no cut and paste, proofread at the end. Okay? Be sure that your proposals are smart. This is not mine, of course, this is by Doran, 1981, but I didn't invent this. But this applies a lot. They have to be specific and measurable. Specific to your science field. You are, in any case, submitting a postdoctoral research program. So it has to be very specific. It has to be also specific for what individual fellowships requires. Things have to be measurable there and attainable. They have to be relevant and timely. Do you remember this expression? I told you I would remind you later. This was one in the evaluations, one of the strengths. It said it was a relevant and timely address. Do you remember that? The proposal has to be relevant and timely. Relevant and timely both for the science and for the policy issue. So it has to be hot and sexy for your science, but also addressing the policy background of individual fellowships. Career development, boosting and enhancement of career perspectives, attractive working conditions, hosting arrangements, supervised, blah, 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 blah. Okay? And it has to be relevant to you. To who you are, to who you are now, and how this fellowship will allow you to become a better and more holistic researcher and scientist. Start early. Get guidance and info. Your access, national contact points, past proposals, whatever. If you are a host and a supervisor, find your experienced researcher early on. If you are researchers, find your hosts early on. Get your policy background together. Write with the eyes of the evaluators. Make it easy for them to score and to score nicely. This is highly competitive. There's proposals that get 90% out of 100 that are not funded. There's proposals that get 92% out of 100 and they don't get funded. It's highly competitive. Why? Because it is highly prestigious. Because it has meant a lot for these 100,000 researchers that we have funded in these past 20 years. It has meant a lot to their career. Successful proposals are smart. And you know what smart means, I told you just in the previous slide. Follow the template and the guide for applicants. Cover everything that is requested. Kiss and kill. Keep it simple and short, keep it large and legible. Smart proposals love details. Write for the scientist, but also write for the non-specialist. Remember, there's 1, 2, and 3. And get your proposal pre-screened and proofread. And I mean, smart proposals are also pre-screened. Now, most of the national contact points in the countries of the European Union and the associated countries, they offer the pre-screening service. There's different versions of the pre-screening service. It can range from a simple check of eligibility to seeing the text, making corrections, etc., etc. It is a painful process for the pre-screener. Okay? So don't take that for granted. But it is a good service, especially in the countries that do it and they do it nicely. So they ask drafts of your proposal and they pre-screen and they check and they tell you. Based on the survivor's guide, pretty much. Use it. And also use the second or the third pair of eyes. Some of the testimonials also mentioned that. They gave it to a colleague. Can you see it? Give it to your supervisor. Give it to whatever sort of national contact point. To your access service if you find help from there. Sometimes it's the same person. But get it pre-screened. Okay? We do that, by the way, in our own. And I used to do it for 9 years at the national contact point, of course, for free, for everyone. Now that I'm not a national contact point anymore, I work for a research institution. I provide that also for, obviously, my researchers, but also our collaborators. And this is how I started the pre-screening 9 years, 8 years ago. It's about proofreading, so commas, full stops, typos, etc., etc., but also deciphering the Brussels English to human English and making strategy suggestions, and sometimes I would even risk text suggestions. All right? It would take me a couple of days. When I became experienced, it would take me a couple of days to properly pre-screen one individual fellowship. So that's a serious thing, okay? If you want to do it right. So this was our approach and our services, our how and our what. And remember, I promised you I would be telling you my why at the end. And this is why I do it. This is why I was doing it also when I was in MSCP, and this is why I keep doing it. Because I seriously believe in holistic and inspirational solutions of environmental, social, and technological consciousness. And I seriously believe in motivating people like you. Because we're doing this for some, we're not doing it for the money. We will always consider ourselves underpaid whatever we do. Even if we get a serious grant from the European Commission. And the European Commission is spending a lot of taxpayer money in this. But it is never enough, right? So it's not about the money that we're doing this. It's not about getting a fund, getting a grant. So it's not about the prestige. It feels right, but it's not about it. It's something deeper. It is the deeper thing that made you a scientist and a researcher. It is why you're here, why you're going to go to the different coast. It is why you became a researcher, what made you become a researcher. This is what keeps you doing it, regardless of how bad the pay is or how prestigious the pay is. Okay? So, domo, arigato, besides.